Hello, I'm Adrian Sanabria, Director of Research for Threatcare, and I want to welcome you to my session for RSA Conference 2018. It's time to kill the pen test. This is an RSA quick look at what I'll be covering. So killing the pen test, what am I talking about here? Understanding the relationship between pen testing and the basics is really important to understand this year. That's kind of the key. And I'm here to convince you that pen tests can and should be replaced, that bad to mediocre pen tests should go away entirely, and the better pen tests should kind of turn into something else. You know, this is really a shift. So we're not abolishing pen testing entirely. You know, that's not what I'm talking about here. But the vast majority of what we call a pen test and what most companies pay for when they talk about having a pen test, I think is mostly a waste of time and money, and I'm going to try and convince you of that. So to be clear, we've got two different things here. Pen testing is the actual skill, you know, the application of skills used to test security controls, to test whether or not something's vulnerable and can be exploited, versus the actual pen test engagement that you might do internally or hire a company to come out and do for you. You know, so mainly what I'm talking about getting rid of here is the assessment, you know, that we roll up as a package and sell as an industry. So what's wrong with the pen test? I think most pen tests, especially as we've seen them become requirements for compliance and regulation, have kind of hit the bottom of the barrel in terms of quality. They're driven by checkbox requirements, and they're very, very inefficient, and we'll go into that in a little bit. A wide variety of services are sold as a pen test and called a pen test, and you know, that's a different issue where we've got a wide variety of definitions for what a pen test actually is, what kind of tasks are included in a pen test, and what kind of skills someone needs to be a pen tester. So even that, you know, when I say pen test, you know, I can get 10 different definitions from 10 of you on what that actually means. And I do believe through my experience interviewing, going through hundreds and hundreds of pen test results, that we know the results most of the time. Experienced pen testers can interview someone for 5 minutes about their environment, about their infrastructure, and tell you exactly what they're going to find before they even touch it. And I think partially because of this, because it's a waste of time, it creates work that's maybe not the highest priority stuff to work on, pen tests can do more harm than good. So where is this inefficiency I'm talking about in the pen test? Your typical pen test, and again, you know, those of you screaming, waving your arms, you know, yes, there are some very high quality pen tests out there that have already reduced this inefficiency. They don't have these same problems, but the typical pen test that we see out there is not what you do, is not what you're envisioning right now. The typical pen test out there has someone come out, they plug in a laptop or a machine, and they're running a vulnerability scanner. And really, this kind of pen test is barely a step away from running that vulnerability scan. You know, so when those results come out, they're going to validate some of those vulnerability results. They're going to try to exploit some of them. If they can exploit some of them, they'll try and pivot from it. But really, this 20% in the center, that's the only pen testing you're getting for what you're paying there. And then the rest of it, typically the results are written up using Microsoft Word, it gets turned into a PDF, you know, maybe somebody, you know, does a review of it, and it goes out. And that takes a long time to write this stuff up, to put that report together. You know, so that's very inefficient as well. And again, you know, I've seen companies that have completely automated the reporting part of this or mostly automated it. And that's not a problem for everybody, but for most pen tests, this is what it looks like. But even further than that, even if you narrow it down to just that 20% that we saw in the center, why am I still saying that Pentest is the wrong choice? You know, this isn't the right type of assessment to do. And again, I should point out here, I'm not talking about doing nothing in place of a Pentest. I'm suggesting a replacement here, something that would be more efficient, more valuable for the amount of money and the amount of time invested rather than a Pentest. So I think Pentests are good once you feel pretty confident about your security program. Once you feel like you have most everything in place, a Pentest is great. You know, it's not going to be a super noisy report. It's not going to be a bona fide prioritized vulnerability scan. That's where Pentest really shines and tests your security program, you know, all that work that you've already put into it. The problem is most organizations out there, and again, I feel like I've got the data to back this up. I've spent over 10 years gathering this data, interviewing people, doing pen tests myself, talking to other people who have done hundreds of pen tests, and I feel like it's a true statement to say most organizations have not reached that point. They're not mature enough where they can really get serious value out of a pen test. But they do it because they're either required to do it or that's just the main item on the menu when we're looking to spend our security budget and we want to know how well that we've done. We reach for a pen test. In a lot of organizations, they're not mature enough, don't have a large enough staff, or don't have the skills in place to even handle the results of a pen test. I've seen cases where remediation for pen test results can take weeks, months, or even years. In some cases, you know, I myself and others I've talked to come back in and for the fifth year do a pen test on the same company and find the same vulnerabilities, even find, you know, some of the same artifacts left over from previous pen tests from that same company, from maybe even that same person. So these are the companies that really aren't benefiting from this. The help they need is in a different area. They really need help with these basics, with the foundational stuff. And what I'm going to suggest as a replacement here really focuses heavily on minimizing the amount of time that we're going out trying to break systems, trying to find problems, and maximizing the time we spend with the client actually helping them fix these things and helping them improve their security directly rather than just saying, this is broken, go fix it. And I think most pen test findings you see out there prove this. You know, I've seen there's a company that has an ad campaign out there. And as part of this ad campaign, they have pen testers sharing stories. And some of these stories, when you listen to them, I don't know what the typical person's reaction, but as an experienced pen tester, when I listen to those stories, my reaction is, man, they really shouldn't have sold that company a pen test. You know, because in some of these cases, the pen testers are talking about, you know, achieving the full goal of a pen test within 10 minutes or half an hour, you know, something really ridiculous, you know, whereas the thing is maybe scoped for 20 or 30 hours. So another way to look at it, I think pen tests are a very slow and expensive way to work your way through those foundational elements of a security program. Or the CIS Top 20 if you want to use a standard that actually kind of spells out a lot of the basics. And as I've talked with people about this, they do point out that on the CIS Top 20, pen testing is the very last item on that list. I think the order is significant there. You know, and the signal that the Center for Internet Security and SANS, who built the Top 20 before that, is trying to send there is that, look, this is, once you've hit the maturity level, you know, this is the prize. Once you've done all the other basics, you get to have a pen test and see how well that you've done. Really doesn't make sense to do that before you've hit any of those basics, or most of them at least. So as I pitch this replacement, some of the things I'm thinking about, I just made a wish list of, you know, if I had a brand new security program or if I had the average security program, what would be on my wish list? And what could we fit into that same amount of money you might spend on a pen test, the same amount of time and effort the pen tester might come out and throw out there? And here's some of what I came up with. You know, I feel, you know, we can assess the state and the maturity of the security program, the maturity of existing controls, so actually testing what you've put in place already, seeing how well it works or if it works at all, and the company's ability to detect and respond. So I think it's really, really important to test the processes and the people here as well. We've seen many breaches. Target is a very notable one where they had several systems report the attackers that got into Target, allegedly quick enough for them to do something about it, maybe to have prevented that breach. But no one saw those alerts. And that's something that should have come up on a very basic assessment that you come in, you know, you have a third party come in and perform for you. And I think it's important to simulate some of these common breach events. And it's very easy to do some of these. You know, if you want to simulate, you know, credit card theft, you know, it's as simple as putting some fake but valid, that look valid, credit card numbers in a text file or a spreadsheet and uploading them somewhere or emailing them to someone. You know, if you're testing DLP controls, it can be as simple as that. And I put in about an hour here because part of what we're trying to do here on the efficiency side is leverage automation and sampling as much as possible to speed things up here. Because if you see five or six systems that aren't running antivirus, you know, or don't have basic controls on them, you don't really need to check the entire rest of the environment. You know, it's clear, you know, or if Java is 3 years out of date, it's clear there's some systemic issues here. You know, so spending any more time figuring out that it's precisely 528 systems missing up-to-date antivirus or that have an old version of Java, you know, that's just not time well spent, especially at whatever rate you're paying your pen tester. So in practice, we can do all these things. I think it can be done. Well, I know it can be done in under 3 hours. If we can get it down to about an hour, I think that's great, because then that leaves the rest of your time that you've contracted with your client to help them actually start building those fundamental controls that they need and showing them how to do that. In the full session, I'll go into why the pen test is ill-suited for most organizations in much more detail. I'll go over our experiments so far with the replacement for that, simulating breaches, directly testing controls, and automating traditional pen test activities. Go into the full details on that, and I'll be speaking directly to how consulting firms can deliver more value for the same price with the same people that they've got today for their clients. You know, and technically, that's competition to me, you know, but, you know, if we're going to make an impact in the industry and we're going to get better at stopping breaches, I feel like we can't have a special sauce here that we keep to ourselves, you know, so I'm sharing this with everybody. And most of all, how buyers can get the most out of that consulting budget instead of just getting that box checked or getting the political justification they need for budget. I think we can do so much more with that same amount of money. So please come out. I'd love to see you at the session. And again, this was a special recording for RSA Quick Look.